Celebration. This is a homegoing celebration. We are celebrating her life because she has a life that is well lived. Amen. To the family, you are in our prayers and you are in our hearts. And so if everyone could remain standing, family, if you want to be seated, it's all right. We'll start with our opening hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far on the way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in your path, we pray. Lord, you already know why we're praying to you today.
Your word says you know what we ask before we even ask it. So God, you know that some of us come to you in grief. Some of us come to you in mourning. Some of us come to you in joy because Sister Miko passed our way. God, we lift up this family. We lift up Brother Baldwin. We lift up Jared and Brianna and Candace. We lift up the entire family. Praying, oh God, for you to give comfort and strength where they need you most. God, we pray for Bethel. Help us, oh God, to take the next steps after this day. God, for all friends and family whose hearts are heavy now, God, we are praying that your word be manifest in our lives. You said you would be the mender of broken hearts. So God, we come casting our cares upon you because you say you care for us. So for every broken heart, we lay it at your feet. For every angry soul, God, we put it before you. For every person that's asking questions, God, why her? Why now? God, we put those questions before you. Lord, we don't know. We don't understand why you do what you do. But God, in this moment, we declare that we trust you. We put our faith in you. We put our hopes in you. And so in this moment, we pray that your spirit would saturate this service. And not just now, but God, after this service is over, let your spirit rest on each and every one of us to keep us in our going and our coming. And even though it sounds crazy, God, we do thank you for Sister Miko's life. For the joy we had when we encountered her. For her wit. For her charm. And how she could be sharp and sassy. God, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. She added color to all of our lives. And for that, oh God, we give you praise. Some of us can testify, Lord, it was raining on the outside, but after we finished talking to Miko, we could see a rainbow. Thank you. Let your will be done on earth, in us, as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We will have the reading of the word, the Old Testament by Reverend Jerry Edmonds, and the New Testament by Reverend Raymond Edwards Jr. And after that, we'll have a musical selection.
The word of God that hails from Proverbs, the 31st chapter, says this: Who can find a virtuous woman? She is worth far more than rubies. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting. But a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate. The word of God.
Testament lesson, 1 Corinthians 15, beginning at verse 51. You find these words, listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And the people of God said, amen.
Uncertainties about your tomorrow seems to grow. One thing you should remember, and you should always know, out of everyone who loves you, I love you the most. I am just a prayer away. Call my name with your heart, and I'll hear every word. And you cry at night, I'll wipe your tears away. Just pray, my love, I'll be there right away. This is God's message to you, family. You don't ever have to wonder about my love. Just put your faith and trust in my care. I will always be there to hold you in my arms. When you're afraid, don't worry, I'll protect you from the storm. Out of everyone who loves you, I love you the most. I am just prayer away. Call my name with your heart, and I'll hear every word you say. I'm right there with you. When you feel by yourself, when you're feeling lonely, all you need to do is call me, and I'm right there, and I'm taking care of your mother right there with me. I'm just one prayer away. All you gotta do is reach out, and I'm right there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. With your heart, I'll hear every word you say. When you cry at night, I'm right there to wipe your tears away. Just pray, my love. I'll be there right away.
Amen. This time we will have acknowledgments, and the family has asked if you would keep them very, very brief, 2 minutes brief. First, we'll have Carla Henry Hopkins. Secondly, Reginald White. Thirdly, Angelique Coleman. Fourth, Pastor Shelley Carter Burton. And last, Tina DeVoe. And after Sister DeVoe speaks, we'll have a silent reading of the obituary and then the church's resolution. You may come in that order. Thank you.
Good morning, family. And I say that because aren't we all family, even if we're not all blood? Yes, we serve a God who's not limited by DNA, and Miko was certainly my sister, not by blood, but by the blood and friendship for many, many, many years, and Auntie Carla to her children. And so that family is our family, and thank you for being here today. The family wishes to acknowledge your presence just by being here today as they celebrate the life of their loved one. Miko's godmother, I'll be reading, let me say from the onset, there were many, many cards, and there were some that kept coming in even on this morning, too numerous to read. The sentiment is the same. The family wants you to know that the sentiment of the cards is that you love them and they feel that love, and they will respond to you at a later time personally. Miko had a godmother, Patsy Holmes, who I believe is watching. She was not able to be here today, but she has sent a letter, and I will be reading a letter and some resolution. Miko Baldwin, the life you live, Miko, surely spoke for you. You were M, the mother of three children that you always wanted, what you felt was best for each of them. I, intelligent and always interested in making positive differences and everything that you did. Kay, keenly interested in making sure everyone knew that you cared about their well-being. Obsessed, with having your opinion heard. Yes, she did. And understood. B, bold in expressing your feelings and your truth. A, active in school and community affairs as a leader. L, loved genuinely and was loved by so many. D, determined to support the Ravens, no matter if they were winning or losing, right? W, willing to go the extra mile for all that you believed in and loved. I, intentional in all that you decided to do. And N, naturally an excellent leader. Miko adopted me as her godmother while attending Milford Mill High School. She was my Sean's friend. She often used my name as a Baltimore County Public Schools administrator to get Brianna, Candace, and Jared placed in the schools of her choice, not their choice. She researched, studied school report card data, and then would call and tell me to help her get her children transferred out of a school that was not working. She would use my name as her godmother to get things done, as she felt that they should be done for all students, not just her children, in the county schools. When Miko became ill, she explained to me that through the years of pain and suffering, when she was going to hospitals, the names of the hospitals, the names of her doctors, and types of her treatment. She wanted to go in detail because she knew I loved her and would be there with her and for her. I never had to wonder how she felt or what she was doing until the last few weeks of her life, because she often called me to tell me how she felt, what she was doing, and when she would go for an appointment. I am her godmother, and she chose me as a teenager. I love Miko and her three children. I will forever miss her and the awesome relationship. In her weakest moments on Friday, March the 2nd, Brianna called me to tell me Miko was very sick, and she wanted to make sure that I knew. Every Saturday morning, March 3rd, I visited Miko for the last time. And even though she was very sick and weak, when she heard my voice, she reached to give me a hug and to tell me that she loved me. I feel so blessed to have been her godmother, and in my absence today, I just wanted you all to know about the love that Miko and I shared and enjoyed. Now to God be the glory, now that she has begun his eternal life with him. Miss Patsy Holmes. And then remembering Miko from Todd Luciano, the vice president of wireless finance and contracting, I'm going to take you back, way back to 2000. It was the year 2000, and many of us didn't know what would happen when 1999 became 2000. There was widespread fear that the change would take down computer systems and infrastructure, such as banking and power plants. In fact, I remember when we were preparing for change at Verizon, the internet was still in its infancy, and no one really knew what to expect. Our IT teams were prepared as best they could with the knowledge that they had. They set up cots in offices and call centers, and they stayed there all night just to watch the clock strike 12. As midnight approached, I am sure they closed their eyes, held their breath, and waited. And do you know what happened? Nothing. And that was a good thing. Fast forward to the fall of that same year, 2000, when something did happen, and it was also a good thing. That's when Miko Baldwin showed up to interview for a customer service position at Verizon Wireless. I'm sure you all can picture it. There she was, dressed up, enthusiastic as ever, and ready to nail her interview. After all, Verizon Wireless had just been formed, and it was a good opportunity to work for a company when the wireless business was still relatively new. Well, she did nail that interview, and she officially started in November 2000. I wonder if she knew back then that her life would change forever. She was now a V-teamer, and that too was a good thing. You see, V-teamers are unique individuals. They are committed to the business. They are committed to customers, and even more committed and loyal to the ones they work with. And Miko was no different. Personally, I will never forget the day I asked Miko what her long-term career goals were. She looked at me strangely and said, "What do you mean?" I said, "You've been here for a long time, and I've never seen you apply for any manager positions." She literally began to cry and stated, "Are you for real? You think I could be a manager?" I said, "Miko, you can be anything you want to be. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise." She proceeded to hug me, and I by no means am a hugger, but I let her do it anyway. Throughout her nearly 24-year career, Miko was fiercely committed to those she served, whether in those early days as a customer service representative, later as a business and government support supervisor, public sector business development consultant, or even more recently, as the manager. Yes, everyone, she became a manager. Supporting state and local government accounts across the country, she treated her customers and her teammates as though Miko knew just how much she was appreciated by all who knew her. We will truly miss her amazing smile, her contagious positive attitude, and her joyous demeanor. At Verizon, when people leave a lasting impression on a team, we refer to them as leaving their thumbprint. Miko left a handprint. Once a V-teamer, always a V-teamer. And then from the City Council President's Office, Nick Mosby, the City Council of Baltimore, be it hereby known to the City Council of Baltimore that we extend our sincere sympathy to the family of Miko Baldwin. The entire membership offers its respectful condolence and directs this resolution to be presented the 16th day of March, 2024, signed by the President of the City Council, Nick Mosby. From the Office of the Comptroller, the resolution be it hereby known to the Comptroller of Baltimore City that he extends his sincere sympathy to the family of Miko Baldwin, and he offers his respectful condolences and presents this resolution on the 16th day of March, 2024, signed Bill Henry, Comptroller of Baltimore. From the Baltimore County Council, a resolution be it hereby known to the Honorable Julian E. Jones, Jr., on behalf of the Baltimore County Council, joins with family and friends in honoring posthumously Miko Baldwin. The council hereby extends its sincerest condolences and warm regards to the family of Miko Baldwin, who entered eternal rest on Monday, March 4th, 2024. The council joins with those assembled on Saturday, March 16th at Bethel AME Church. We invite the community to gather and celebrate the life of Miss Miko Baldwin and the remarkable memories that she created. And it is signed Julian Jones, who is the chairman of the 4th District Baltimore County Council. And finally, from the Baltimore County Council, be it hereby known to all that the Honorable Pat Young, on behalf of the Baltimore County Council, joins with family and friends in honoring posthumously Miko Baldwin. The council extends its respect to the family of Miko Baldwin, who entered eternal rest. Miko was a resident of the Parkview Trail community. She was a caring mother of three and a grandmother of three, an alumni of Milford Mill Academy, and active in community activism for Baltimore County Schools. The county joins with family and friends on this day, March 16th, in celebrating the life of Miko and in paying tribute to a lady who loved life itself and leaves a legacy of love to her family, friends, and all who were fortunate to know her. And that is signed by Pat Young, the councilman of the 1st District. May God continue to bless each of you, and may you continue to keep this family in your prayers, not only in today, but in the days, the weeks, and certainly in the time to come. God bless you all.
Everyone, family, hey Milford, trying to get it together here. Let's talk about Miko real quick. I got 2 minutes, sorry. Let's talk about the fighter. She fought for everything she wanted, and she got it. She fought cancer like a, and she fought alumni, she fought the housing, she fought for her kids. And if we know anything about it, she was a fighter. Brian, Gigi, everybody that's here, we know how she put the alumni together, and we would have an idea, and Miko would say, well, I don't know about that. And she would usually win every argument that we had. It was only a few of us that could try to get our conversation or our opinion to Miko, but she loved what she do. She loved it. She loved it. And she loved everybody she was with. She loved you, Day-Day. It's like everybody does. But Milford wouldn't be Milford without her. And going to miss you, Miko. I'm going to miss you. I'm going to keep it brief to the family. Psalms 30 and 5. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy come in the morning.
Angelique Coleman.
Good morning,
to everyone. I'm Anjali Coleman, and I am a member of the Flossy Posse, and I'm gonna put this mic down. Miko and I met each other when I was in the 10th grade. And she's gonna get me for telling this story, but I'm gonna tell it. I tried out for the pom-poms. I'm not a dancer, I'm not a mover, I'm surely not a shaker at all. Miko was one of the judges, along with a young lady named Michelle Mimi. You all probably still remember Mimi. I did not make the squad. I didn't make it. And when Miko and I reunited in 2014, I brought that story up to her. I said, Miko, I can't believe that you didn't let me get on the pom-poms. She went to her closet, and she got me a pom-pom. She said, here, now you're on the squad. But that was Miko. We, from there, built a sisterhood, a friendship, a partnership, and not only did we travel, Miko was the reason that I was able to touch the Pacific Ocean for the first time. She planned a trip for my birthday, and she said, Angie, here's to you, and it was just an awesome thing. But that's what Miko did. She made people feel good. She let every single person that she came in contact with know that she loved you and she cared about you for real. I was coaching at Milford on the softball team. She came to one of the practices, one of the games, and she looked, she said, why them girls got them uniforms on looking like that? I said, Miko, this is what we have. She called up Brian Jordan, and I saw Brian in here. Hello, Brian, and I'm still thanking you. She called Brian Jordan. The baseball and the softball team had new uniforms. A word. We traveled Jamaica, Vegas, the Bahamas, just anywhere, Chicago. We went to a Ravens game in Chicago. Didn't watch the game. We went to eat before the game was over. But I love Miko. I will always love her. She will always be my Flossy Posse travel partner. And I don't know what this world is going to do without her. But I challenge everybody to do something good, because that's what Miko will want for us. Thank you.
Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on, put your hands together for God. This is a celebration, isn't it? It's a celebration. 4 weeks ago, I talked with my sister, and she said, Shelly, we've got to get the celebration together. It's going to be big. And when I drove down Druid Hill Avenue today, I just began to weep because she saw it before it happened. Come on, you can put your hands together. She was prepared. She was ready. She was ready. So Miko and I have 40 years of relationship. I remember when Candace was born. I remember when Brianna was born. I remember when Jared was born. Actually, 7 months ago when my brother passed, Miko served at his homegoing, at his repass, actually. And my brother and Sean grew up together and were really close. So down through the years, we've experienced a lot of things together. That I've always been her little sister. She's always been my big sister, and she always knew everything. Y'all know Miko. She always knew everything. But there was a season where we depended on each other a whole lot. And that season was when both of us endured breast cancer. That season was a season that we had to pull on God like never before. That season was a season that we had to encourage each other like never before and tell each other that no matter whether we go to the doctors or not, no matter what they say, there's something greater on the other side. And so my seasons with Miko have been mountaintops and valleys. But I'm grateful today because the last few months of her life was so pivotal. About 4 months ago, Miko was in Mercy, and I'm going to take my seat. I'm a preacher, but I promise you I'm not going to preach. I went to see Miko in Mercy, and Miko was sitting up in the bed. And I came with a purpose, Bishop. I came to tell Miko, now is the time to get it right if you don't have it right. See, we forget that because we just assume that everybody has it right, whether they're in church or not. So I came with communion, I came with prayers, and I came with a lot of hugs. And that was a moment that Miko reflected on her life. Christy was there, Rhonda was there, and we were talking to her about some of the things that she needed to relinquish. Some of the things that she needed to let go so that she could leave in peace when God was ready for her to go. We had communion, we had prayer, and Miko relinquished. But what I really want you to know, and I'm taking my seat, is that the weekend that she, and I know they say it all the time, but the weekend that Miko surrendered her spirit to the Lord, I was there. And I was there, and I got from her that she had a message for the bereaved, those that believe, and those that are broken. The message for those that are bereaved is, it is going to be okay. From the mouth of Miko, she said, it is going to be okay. To those that believe, she said, it's better on the other side. And she pointed to where she was looking at. I want you to understand that this was a moment that she was in and out of sleep, but she understood that I have to get a message back to the celebrants that are coming to celebrate my celebration. She also had a message for the broken, and this is what I leave you with. The message for the broken is fix it. This is not what I made up. This is not what I conjured up. I did not sit and create some quick message. But Miko said out of her mouth with little breath in her body, fix it. And I just came today to let you know that the only reason why this celebration is as it is because Miko looked back and thought about you and she was entering in. She said, fix it. Fix your life with Christ. Fix your life with people. Fix your life with family members. Fix it. Turn from your evil ways and fix it.
Well, fix it sounds about right. She was extremely bossy. Miko and I literally met right here on this fourth pew. David and I came to Bethel as Jamal was leaving and David was coming in. And Aunt Betty said, Miko is assigned to you. And of course, once Aunt Betty tells you that it's an assignment, it's just an assignment. Well, Samir got in a brand new pair of cowboy boots. He was 2, Jared was 4. He took this boot and kicked her in her shin as hard as he could. She snatched him by the back of his neck. I said, oh, we're going to be real good friends. And from that day forward, we've just been connected. I had 3 kids. She had 3 kids. Jared and Candace both came to North Carolina, where we lived, to school. And I remember her calling me and said, tag you it. I'm out. They're all yours, and they never left. Candace eventually came home, but it's hard to believe that 28 years later, this village that we built, it always stood. I never had to look for it. I never had to wonder if I could trust it. I just would pick up the phone, and anything I was mad about or frustrated about, she would just be sitting in there. If she felt like listening, she was a great listener. If she didn't, she would snatch off her wig and be like, girl, hurry up and get to the end. But it never failed. It was like, okay, let me get this last part out, and I would get it out. She'd be like, okay, I'm gone. When it came to the kids, it wasn't a question of, did I know if they were okay? I knew that my kids were okay when they were with her, and she knew that her kids were okay when they were with me. You didn't have to check. I don't know if they're going to be here for 3 days or 3 weeks. But whenever you come back, she knew they were going to be in good hands. On her journey out, this is part of the village. This is my oldest daughter, Dalia, and this is Carla. Carla called me to tell me about Juan and Miko, and she said, all right, sis, it's time to come home. I said, okay, and that's how we talk to each other. We don't do a lot of, you know, mincing of words. And I came home, and I sat in the room. I said, all right, I'm here. What do we need to talk about? I said, all right, where's the paperwork? She said, top drawer to the left. Pull that out. She said, now I got something tucked away under there. Move that to the side. Don't say nothing about that. I said, okay. She said, now, did you call Jamal? Because he needs to preach my funeral. And I said, well, I think he'll come. She never asked. When we were at Empowerment Temple, we were like being fancy and doing big things, right? And so all of a sudden, Devin, who's here, I saw Devin. Devin came in and said, Miko is here, and she said she needs to see Jamal. And I said, well, where you can't call him Jamal anymore. He's the pastor. I don't care how long we've known him. Like, we have to put a title on his name. And she said, no, I already went over. Don't see, you be moving too slow. I already went there and told him what I need to tell him. I said, okay, all right. Goodbye, lady. Thanks for stopping by. But she was a friend, and we all know they're hard to come by. And so I always wanted to tell her, thank you for being my friend. We have traveled down many roads and back again. You were my girl, but you were my confidant. And today we threw you a party, and we invited everybody that you knew. I came to find out that you were the greatest gift to me. Thank you for being my friend.
Will the members of Bethel AME Church please stand for the reading of the resolution in memory of Sister Miko Baldwin. Whereas God in his infinite wisdom called from labor to reward our beloved Sister Miko Baldwin, we the pastor, first lady, stewards, ministers, trustees, officers, and members of Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church offer to you, Sister Candace, Sister Brianna, family and friends, our sincerest condolences. We share your grief as Sister Miko was a very special to the Bethel Church family. However, we have this assurance that God's way is the best way and his thoughts are far above ours. Whereas Sister Miko became a member of this church family February 9, 1992 and served Christ and his church, remaining true and faithful to the ministries to which she was committed. Sister Miko diligently assisted in the work of hosting annual conferences. She previously served with the YPD and the Kingdom Win Women's Ministry. Her faith was not without works. Sister Miko's smile and dedication to the work of the church brought light and love to everyone she met. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Sister Miko Baldwin's work, love, compassion, and example of Christianity will have a lasting place in the hearts and lives she touched in the Bethel AME Church family. And be it resolved, as we come together to celebrate the life of our beloved Sister Miko, we encourage you, Sister Candace Baldwin, family and friends, to join us in taking comfort in these words spoken by David in Psalm 116:15. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And be it further resolved that this resolution be submitted to the family and a copy filed in the permanent records of the Bethel AME Church, submitted by the order of Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church, Baltimore, Reverend Patrick D. Claiborne, PhD, Senior Pastor, March 16th, 2024. Amen.
First, I want to acknowledge any clergy that are present that are not a part of Bethel's ministerial staff. If you're here and you're able to stand, please stand. We just want to recognize you. If you can't stand, just wave your hand. We praise God for your presence. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you. The eulogist for the hour is none other than the Reverend Dr. Jamal Harrison Bryant. Praise God. As you all know, he is a son of this church. He is a friend of the family. He's also a Morehouse brother of mine. Praise the Lord that. I happened to meet him some 30 plus years ago. He was what we called a super senior when I was a freshman. And I can't tell any more of that story, but just know that he was a big man on campus. But he does not come to us as son of Bethel. He does not come to us as Morehouse brother. He doesn't even come as a friend of the family. He comes as the preacher in this hour, who started Empowerment Temple, I believe in the year 2000, right here in Baltimore, and now is celebrating 5 years as the pastor of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia. And to let you know how much love he has for this family, tomorrow is his actual anniversary as the pastor. They're having a celebration tomorrow. Now, typically, pastoral celebrations, anniversary celebrations are weekend long, but he carved out time to be here for them this weekend. And so we're thankful for your presence here today. So after this next musical selection, the voice you'll hear will be the voice of the Holy Spirit as the Holy Spirit speaks through her servant, the Reverend Dr. Jamal Harrison Bryant.
Though the storms keep on raging in my life, and sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day, still that hope that lies within is reassured as I keep my eyes upon that distant shore. I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. Oh, and when the storms don't cease, thank you, God, and just in case the winds, they keep on has been
God, but in the Word of God, I got an anchor, and it keeps me steadfast, unmovable, despite the tide, and with the storms. Saints, when it seems like they won't see, and the winds, when the winds keep on blowing in your life, my soul, my soul's been anchored in the Lord. It holds me fast. So dark the day, clouds in the sky, I know it's all right. Jesus and I, you put me down, he picks me up, and he sticks right by me when the going gets tough. Soul has been anchored, my soul has been anchored. My soul has been anchored. My mind is anchored. I will not go crazy. I will not go crazy. I will not go crazy. My soul has been anchored. Soul has been anchored. Soul has been anchored. Oh,
bless the Lord. Would you stand to your feet for just one moment? Ask that you'll take your neighbor by the hand. We serve a prayer answering God. We're mindful in our gathering on today that the Bible is clear that our people die from a lack of knowledge. There's no way that we can come in this gathering and ignore the fact that black women are 35% more susceptible to breast cancer. We'd be derelict in our responsibility that our sisters, our mothers, and our daughters are the least to get early testing that leads to prevention. All heads are bowed, all eyes are closed. Lord, I pray for the person whose hands I'm holding. All the more for every woman who's in their family. We're only calling on you because we know you are a healer. God, 2 weeks before resurrection, we pray that you'll stop the death of a mother, a sister, a daughter, an aunt. I pray for healing to take place even in this moment. Dispatch angels to hospice pray, dear Lord, for a mother who's dehydrated, for an aunt who has gone through a mastectomy, for a daughter who felt a lump this morning in the shower. There is nothing too hard for you. Now, God, do what you do best. Heal, set free, and deliver. And we promise to give your name glory. And those of you who know you serve a God who is stronger than cancer, would you loose that hand and give God glory even now? While you're yet standing, we're mindful that this is not a funeral, but it is a homegoing celebration. We're not trying to find out where the honoree is. We know where she is. Would you give God glory for a life well lived? I'm appreciative for our pastor. Thank you, Dr. Claiborne, and First Lady Sherry. Thank you so very much to our officers, leaders of this great church, to these strong children. I want to really pause to celebrate the strength of Miko's children. I'm grateful. Come on, let's give God glory for them, for their strength, for their tenacity. When I was first starting out in ministry from this pulpit, Bishop Reed, then Pastor Reed, said to me, when somebody's mother's died and you go to the house, don't tell them you know how they feel if you're going home to see your mother. And so I have no idea what this feeling is that they're going through, but I do know that your presence and your support after the funeral is going to be a whole lot more important than today. And I want them to know that they've got a great cloud of witnesses, not just in the air, but on the ground. I have a whole lot that I want to say in a short amount of time. I want you to join me in John chapter 18. John chapter 18. Verse number 10. John 18, verse 10 in the New International Version says, then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it out and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. Thus far the word of God. I want to preach for a little while today using as a subject, Miko will fight you. You turn to the person beside you. Tell the person beside you, Miko will absolutely fight you. I pastor now in Atlanta, Georgia, which is considered the epicenter of civil rights and the home of what the globe calls the Apostle of Peace, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Second only to Ralph Bunche in receiving a Nobel Peace Prize. It is strikingly significant and whispered how wild it is that he modeled for us the philosophy of Mahatma Gandhi, in the ideals of our loving Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to turn the other cheek. He knew what it was like to have his home bombed, to receive death threats, to walk across the Edmund Pettus Bridge and to be met by barking dogs, fire hoses. How about what people really do not discuss is Martin Luther King was surrounded by the deacons of defense. And they were, now that I'm Baptist, they were gun-toting deacons who loved the Lord. They loved God, but wanted to protect their leader. And the more you live in this thing called life, you got to have somebody in your corner who will fight for you in rooms you are not in. Somebody who will have your back when they want nothing in return. Somebody who loves you with no strings attached. A lot of great flowery things have been said about Miko on today. But I want you to know I was bullied into being here. I'm supposed to be in Atlanta. They're having a celebration for me today. And Pastor Claiborne called me, Tina called me and said, Miko said you're going to be doing the eulogy. They didn't ask was my calendar free or whether I had something to do. But Miko was that kind of person who would fight you behind closed doors but wouldn't let other people talk about you. She is a rare gift. I didn't know her in elementary school, but for those of you who just met her, Miko was the kind of person, if you went to public school, you will understand. Miko was the kind of person who had to have silver caps in her mouth. If you didn't go to public school, then you have no idea what I'm talking about right now. She was that kind of raw person. We got two different, those of you who are not from Baltimore, from out of town, or you moved here, you got to understand the Hatfields and the McCoys are in this church right now. Because anybody who went to Milford thought they was better than everybody else in the city. And I don't want you to get it twisted. It is not because Baltimore County Schools was any better than Baltimore City. They just thought they were better because they had Super TV before the rest of us. Some of y'all ain't even old enough to know what that is. That's before Netflix. That's before Hulu. That was our first form of cable. But Miko was the kind of person who loved you enough to pull you up when you were wrong. Love you enough to correct you. She had an undocumented personality disorder. She didn't know whether she was your sister, your mother, your friend, your wife. I don't even know how her kids became my godchildren. She would go tell Jared, go sit with your godfather over there. Jared, you're gonna be a preacher one day. Jared knew he didn't want to be a preacher. I knew he didn't want to be a preacher. But that was the kind of relationship that she had. No matter how high you went in this life, she felt ordained to keep you humble. And she was, I want to say, in absentia, she was a big sister to both me and Kevin Lyles. and will pull both of us up and hold both of us accountable. Only in death would I tell you we hated her. But we loved her for who she was and for what she represented. And to show you that Jesus had that kind of ghetto passport, Jesus kept one thug around who really represented Miko. It was a guy by the name of Peter. And the rest of the disciples were erudite and well-spoken and articulate, but Peter was the only one of the disciples who never spoke in tongues but knew how to cuss. He was the cussing disciple. All the other disciples had been transformed. They had a relationship with God. They had the transfiguration. They saw Jesus walk on water, turn fish and five loaves of bread to feed 5,000. But just in case, Peter kept a switchblade. Peter was from over east. He was that kind of a disciple. And the night that the police came to arrest Jesus, they had no legal documentation, no search warrant. And there's a fight that is going on outside because they're trying to figure out which one was Jesus, because they all now look like him. And it is significant that not only did they all look like him, but they all dressed like him, because they all had on fine linen robes. I wonder if the authorities would come in, would they be able to tell which one of us really follow Jesus? Do we talk like him? Do we act like him? Do we walk like him? Ladies and gentlemen, might I suggest to you that they went to go arrest Jesus, and here comes Peter acting like Miko. And he goes into his pocket, pulls out a switchblade, and chops off his ear. When he chops off his ear, for those of you who graduated from Sunday school, I wanted you to know the significance of what happened and why it was so meaningful. We're now on the other side of Black Lives Matter, on the other side of Freddie Gray, on the other side of George Floyd. And what you don't even understand is that aggressive policing started with the Roman government. And the Roman government would target minorities. And as a consequence, because there was a spirit not of Dr. King, but really of Fred Hampton, that said that the police were really citizens on patrol. Peter, aka Miko, did not like how they were handling Jesus. So he pulled out a switchblade and with one fell swoop, chopped off his ear. The reason, Bethel, the reason, family, the reason, Milford, that this is so important is that according to Roman law, this is a capital offense. And it's a capital offense that is warranting crucifixion. The reason why I bring that to bear, because according to the police manual, they should have shifted in arresting Jesus and should have arrested Peter that night. But not only should they have arrested Peter that night, but the next day, Jesus should not have been crucified. Peter should have. So I need you to know what happened is that Jesus sees what has happened and a capital offense has taken place and Peter should be crucified. Watch what Jesus does. Jesus scoops down, picks up the ear, places it on Malchus's head. Here's why that's significant, because Jesus wanted to get rid of the evidence.
had they been able to show what Peter had done, he would have gone to court that day. You want to know why you ought to be shouting today? The reason why you ought to be shouting is God got rid of the evidence that should have got you killed. I know you sitting in church acting like you did everything right and you dotted all the I's and crossed all the T's, but if there's anybody that can say he looked beyond all of my faults and he saw me at my knees, that's why you ought to be giving God glory. But you really gonna sit in church and act like you ain't done nothing wrong, like you haven't fallen short? Somebody ought to be saying, look at me, I'm a testimony. I didn't make it on my own. Somebody prayed for me. Jesus got rid of the evidence. But the reason why it's so important is that Peter was so engulfed and enraged in anger about what they were doing to Jesus. He should have cut off the soldier's hand. If he wanted to stop him from processing Jesus, he should have chopped off his feet. He chopped off his ear because he didn't want him to hear the good news. Do you know how dangerous you are just by hearing what God has said? Did you hear what Reggie said today? Weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. The enemy didn't want you to hear. No weapon that is formed against you shall be able to prosper. Your grandmother wanted to make sure you heard. He may not come when you want him to come, but he's an on-time God. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up on wings as eagles, run and not get weary, walk and not faint. He didn't want them to hear it, but I heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Somebody ought to know today, I don't know what you came from and I don't know what you came through. I want you to know, no matter how far you have gone away from church and how far you've gone away from the will of God for your life, if you can hear my voice, you still got time to get yourself together. You still got time to say, one day when I was lost, Jesus died on the cross and I know it was the blood that saved me. Y'all acting like you ain't saved. But if your name is written in the book of life, and you know that when the last trumpet will sound, that you're going back with him, you ought to rejoice always. And again, you ought to rejoice. Miko will fight you. And I wanted you to, no, I wasn't talking to your neighbor. I don't need you to shake anybody by the hand. I wanted to preach today, not to you, not even to the kids. I wanted to preach today to cancer. Sometimes God will allow you to go through something that's not even for you. He'll make you go through something so you'll have a fresh testimony about what God is able to do. Jesus received a text message one day from Mary and Martha that said, come quick. The one you love is sick unto death. And I wanted to show you something. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it significant? We never knew Jesus loved Lazarus until he got sick. Sometimes it is in sickness that you find out how much love God has for you. Sometimes when you don't have the strength to purport yourself, that God has got to show you that you got to lean into me and not your own understanding. He said, this sickness is not unto death. This sickness, hear this, is only not so that Johns Hopkins can get the credit. That this sickness is only so I can get some glory. Have you considered how desperate God is, that God had to figure out how to get you to church on a Saturday morning when you had so much other stuff you thought you had to do? But he said, I'm going to disrupt your program, because if I don't get you here today, you're going to think you can wait till Easter. But there's somebody that needs to know, I got to give him glory. He's been better to me than I've been to myself, and I owe him glory. When was the last time you gave him glory? And why would God manipulate the circumstances of your life just so that you could praise him? I'm glad you asked. I want you to remember the last time he saw Lazarus. Last time he saw Lazarus, there was a private dinner party. One sister was in the kitchen frying chicken, and the other sister was open up a bottle from Bath Body and Beyond and open up some oil and begin rubbing his feet. And Lazarus was sitting in the lazy boy chair watching SportsCenter on ESPN. And Jesus never corrected him. He just made a mental note that everybody in the house is serving me but Lazarus. So let me make Lazarus go through something so that the next time he sees me, he won't need a praise team or a tambourine or background music. He'll just be glad just to be in my presence. Jesus shows up at the cemetery and said, show me where you laid him. They rolled away the stone, and I want you to know something significant. Lazarus never got a call on his life until he died. God don't need anybody that's perfect. He only needs somebody who's been through a testimony, that's been through a trial. And I want you to know that Lazarus came forth, y'all ain't gonna like it, and Jesus never promised him to be debt free. Lazarus began jumping, and God never promised him a Maybach or a Benz. God called his name, and he never promised him he was gonna live in a 10,000 square foot house. He was giving God glory, here's your shout, because he knew he was supposed to be dead. While you sitting in that pew, you ought to be shouting, no, when you should be laying in this casket. But he called your name this morning. And because he called your name, you ought to be saying to yourself, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out hallelujah. I thank him for saving me. Look at your neighbor, say, God been too good for you to sit there with your arms folded. Been too good for your legs to be crossed. Don't make me fight you today. He died for you. He got lifted up for you. And it feels like fire. Shut up in my bone. Is there anybody here that's got a praise on the inside? Would you give God a praise and thank him that he woke you up this morning? On your way, keep on running in your feet, keep on clapping in your hands. Thank him, rise, shine, give God glory, glory, glory.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God some praise for that word. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you're able to stand with me as we give the benediction. Now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think. Now unto him who's able to wipe tears from our eyes. Now unto him who's able to wake us up in the morning and give us fresh and new mercy. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his throne with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now and forever. And the people of God say, amen.
Amen.
Amen.